Good evening, everyone. Hope you're doing well. Hey, while we're there, would you just give a huge welcome to everyone joining us online tonight? We are back. We are back with a live stream coming live all over planet Earth, which is pretty cool with technology. And I just want to give a special shout out to all those amazing people that we got to meet last weekend in Seoul, Korea. On Yangaseo, Kosamida. On Sarahamida to all of you in Korea. They'll be watching in an amazing church location in Hongdae, Seoul, in Seoul, which is a part of Seoul, one of the coolest parts of South Korea. Would you just welcome everyone that's over there in Korea? They're live in church right now. Also, those in connect groups in London, and those in connect groups in Newcastle, and over there, a big hello to Grant and Whitney in Houston. Some really exciting stuff happening in Houston. Oh, it's all happening. And all of you on the Gold Coast in person. Good to see you. Good to see you. Hey, we've also got with us tonight here in the room, and for those of you watching from the UK, it's early morning over there. It's, what, 7? I don't know. It's like 8 a.m. in there at the moment in England. But the exciting thing is we've got a whole bunch of your young people here that have been here. Hey, if you're here from England, would you stand to your feet? All those for Glow Church UK. Come on, stand up. Give me a huge cheer. I know they're in parts all around, over here. They're in some of the back rooms as well. God save the Queen, hey? Good to see you guys. Good to see you all, hey? Now, we just had this week, we had our leadership intensive for all the different cities from around Australia and in England. They all flew in here for the last few days with our lead pastors. It was such a good time. So keep your ears peeled. We've got some great things happening for, if you're a young person here, your ears peeled? No. Yeah. Your eyes peeled and your ears peeled. Everyone listening? Just checking you're listening. Let's pray. Father, we thank you as we get into the Word of God tonight. We are ready for this incredible book that, Lord, could easily just be defined as a bestseller or something that is carried on the arms of people to look impressive at times. But yet, actually, it's living and breathing. And when we open it, Lord, has the power to change even the hardest of hearts, to turn up and bring hope in people's hearts, Lord, when things maybe look like there's no hope. We pray tonight as we hear the Word of God that you would speak to every person everywhere. Lord, whether they're in the room or whether they're online, Father, we just pray that, God, you would bless each person and that, God, you would change our hearts. We want to become more like you and be transformed into the knowledge of you and be more like you. And everyone said? Amen. Now, hopefully you know the person that's sitting next to you before we get into the message tonight. If you don't, then you should introduce yourself. You never know. They could be the person you marry one day. You never know. I've heard true stories. Got to be at a wedding last week, and I got to hear about a true story of someone at a Glow YA retreat that had speed dating, and they met each other and got married. So there we go. Joel and Phoebe, good to see you back from the honeymoon. Joel, my newest family member, good to see you, mate. Second Joel in the family. Second best one, but it's good to see you. All right, we're going to get into the deep dive series. You might be wondering, what is a deep dive? Well, across all our locations around the world, we have earmarked this next few weeks between now and in August to, in each location, focus on a particular book of the Bible and to go deep. So instead of just at times jumping around topics, when you read the story of somebody's life or you go through a book of the Bible from start to finish, it brings a lot of context to what the author is trying to say. And who the author is God. God's trying to speak into our lives. And no matter what book of the Bible we're talking about, I just feel like sometimes you can insert your own name into it. So the stories that we hear, the lives that people have lived, you can say, hey, I can relate to that. I can experience that. And so when we go through a deep dive through the start to the finish of a book, it means also you can be, during the week, you can be reading ahead. For all those that are high achievers in the room, for all those that are online that are highly intelligent people, you could be reading ahead and you could actually catch your own revelation before we get to the messages on a Sunday. Or you could even after Sunday, after, if there's anything that's been said that kind of catches your interest and think, man, I want to do some more research about that. I know that, like, you know, here on the Gold Coast, we've had services all day and each location is going to have a different book of the Bible. And actually, we're going to be putting them all on podcasts this week. So you can watch Tuesday, I think is Gold, whoever it is, one day is Melbourne, the next day is Sydney, the next day is Gold. You can be like deep diving everywhere if you want to, which is going to be a lot of fun. But here on the Gold Coast, I really felt like we had to do something that is really important.
10 years ago, in 2013, when we started Glow Church, we were just one location here in sunny Queensland. Back then, Queensland were winning State of Origin series like they still are winning State of Origin series. And even though I'm a missionary from Sydney that came up here. And back then, the church looked very different. We were just like maybe 150 people in a primary school hall about 10 minutes from here. Never even thought it possible that we'd be in all parts of the world 10 years later. And I preached from a book of the Bible that had so much impact on people's lives. I didn't have the impact, the book had the impact. And it literally formed and shaped, I believe, so much of what's happened over the last 10 years. And as I was praying and really seeking God this year on what are we going to speak on during Deep Dive this year, during our teaching series, I really felt like God just keeps stirring my heart to go back and preach from this book again 10 years later, to relook with the different lens of what felt like we were speaking things out in faith 10 years ago is now that we are speaking into the reality of all that God has been doing. And I wonder what God could do in the next 10 years of this church with what he's done in the last 10 years. And I know that we're in a really, really interesting season in life in general, globally. There's things that are happening that many people never thought they'd see in their lifetime. And I really sense that this series is a now word for this church. Even though we might have spoken it 10 years ago, the good thing is I went to my Dropbox to find if I could find all the messages from back then, but I must have been too busy trying to start a church and be a full-time school teacher that there was none. And the podcasts aren't available anymore. There was no YouTube back then. There was no live streaming. Literally, I thought, this is a great opportunity to go back with a fresh lens and read from the Word and catch new revelation and add to it. So if that's okay, we're about to deep dive into the book of Nehemiah. Nehemiah, which is on page 408, if you've got your Bibles. Well, that's what my Bible says. It's 408. You can see all the yellow in there. That's my highlighter. They say if you're going to go to heaven, you've got your little highlighters in the Bible. That does help. This is my evidence. But I think that I would say context is key. Context is king. If this week you go to work and your manager gets upset or angry at you and you feel like, man, what have I done wrong this week? And you find out later that this week that their wife or their husband has left them during the week, that would bring context and you want to give them a bit of grace to say, well, hey, I didn't realize that was going on. You can yell at me all you want if that's what's going on in your life. See, context matters in any scenario. When it comes to the Word of God, I think often context can be missed and understanding can be missed, but so much of the truth of God's Word comes out when you understand context. When history comes out, like the History Channel, when you can see with your own eyes or when you can experience the feelings, the smells, the sounds, or potentially what the people in this story were going through. Nehemiah was born in a city called Persia or modern-day Iran. Nehemiah was actually of Jewish descent, so he had heard stories from his family. He'd heard of the people around his life that would have been family members that would have celebrated specific Jewish festivals, but he had never been to Jerusalem or to Israel. Where he was living was 1,100 kilometers, or the distance from about Sydney to Brisbane away, for those that live here in Australia. He was a long way away. Yet, his heart was for the people of Israel. His Jewish heritage meant that his heart was so fond of hearing of news of what was happening in the holy city of Jerusalem. The only issue is that when Nehemiah was alive, Jerusalem was a rubble and a pile of mess. It wasn't the mighty city that at once it was, or maybe what it is today. Jerusalem had been sieged, had been destroyed, and had been ransacked and burnt to the ground by the Babylonians, which is the modern-day Iraq nation. Baghdad, which is probably the closest place to Babylon, they came and they ransacked Jerusalem, and 50 years later, the Persians or the Iranians came and ransacked the Babylonians in Babylon. Talk about what you sow, you reap in many ways, when all of a sudden it feels like what you thought once you were doing to somebody else came back and it bit you in the behind. You've got to be careful what you do in life. And I would say as Christians are very careful not to burn bridges of relationships with people. It's a very small world at times, and you've got to always remember that the more you keep your bridges up, the more you can always walk back over it if you need to. And so in this particular story, we see this destruction and breakdown. And so Nehemiah is, in this context, he is one of the people that when that city was destroyed, they were in exile, or they were captives, they were slaves of this Medo-Persian Empire. And 100 years later is when we pick up this story of Nehemiah, this Jewish man that is sitting in the king's palace. He's there for a particular reason, which is very significant. And at this particular time in history, King Artaxerxes has decided that three waves of people that were Jewish would be allowed to return back to the homeland of Israel, or Judah at the time. And so the first group of 50,000 people is led by a man called Zerubbabel. Everyone say that word, Zerubbabel. That's a hard one to say. Good name for maybe a new baby. Zerubbabel, little Zubby, little Zebs, little Bubbles, whatever you want to call him, right? Zerubbabel. Zerubbabel is a man that leads 50,000. And then there's a second wave of Jewish people going to Israel, led by a man called Ezra. Ezra is a book in the Bible that you can read about. That's the book before Nehemiah, I'm pretty sure. Is that right? It is in mine. There you go. And Ezra is charged with rebuilding the temple. So he rebuilds the temple on behalf of the Jewish people, so they now have a place to worship. But here's the problem. The city of Jerusalem is at risk of being invaded by anyone at any time because there's no defense mechanism. There's no walls of protection to safeguard all those that are in the city. And so when we read Nehemiah chapter 1, verse 1, all that context really matters for your understanding of what we can learn from God's word tonight. And so I'm going to read from the word of God from the new NIV version, New International Version. Those of you watching online, we're so glad that you are joining us. Hey, don't forget, every week we've now got like live hosts before and after the service. Big shout out to Mike Weber and to Melody Davis, who are hosting before the service, and we'll be afterwards so you can ask questions and you can type questions. Here we go. Number one, verse one. The word of Nehemiah, or if the Hebrew is Nehemiah, or Nehemiah, son of Hakaliah, in the month of Kislev, which is actually between November and December in the Jewish calendar, in the 20th year, while I was in the citadel of Susa, which is in Iran, Hanani, one of my brothers, came from Judah, Israel, with some other men, and I questioned them about the Jewish remnant that survived the exile and also about Jerusalem. They said to me, those who survived the exile are back in the province and are in great trouble and are in disgrace. The wall of Jerusalem is broken down and its gates have been burned with fire. Now that context that we just learned about tells us a lot already. What are walls for? I don't know about your house looks like, whether you've got like a little white picket fence and living the Australian dream, or whether you've got that big collar bond fences that makes it look like you have an issue with security, or you've got a big guard dog that you want to keep in. Whether at your house you have like one of these fences with an electric fence, then you've got to be very careful with your animals around it. But typically speaking, fences serve two purposes. One is to keep people from coming in to your property. And secondly, it's to keep things in so they can't get out. That's the typical nature of fences. For example, at a prison, the reason the walls are there are so that people can't get out. Right? So two purposes. The only way you get in and out of a prison is through a very narrow door. That's got security checks. It's got places. Your house has got a gate to come in and out of. Maybe you've got a little intercom to get people in. Typically speaking, walls serve a very, very crucial part of the story of protection and allowing things in and out. The gate plays a big purpose as well. Last week when we were in Seoul, myself and Moni and Joey, we actually went to what's called the demilitarized zone, which is the border of South and North Korea, which is only an hour from Seoul. And in order to get into that first stage of the demilitarized zone, where you can literally get to, and you can see in the distance, you can see North Korean guards, you can see the flag waving in Phnom Penh, you can see all the different areas of North Korea, which you know you've heard about in the news, but we saw them with our own eyes. And we went into the tunnels under the ground where there was four tunnels that were discovered in the 70s and 80s where North Korea was trying to invade into South Korea underneath the demilitarized zone. So we walked all the way under this zone and actually could touch the wall where North Korea is. But to get into that zone, we were on the bus with our passports, and as the guards came on from the Korean military, we had to show our passport and have us signed off that you could now enter into this zone. It was a very narrow channel. Even though there was lots of fences, which was to keep people in and out, we had to go through that through the official protocols and the official process. Now, here's what I want to say to you. As we see in this story in a moment, if you're not careful in your life, if the spiritual walls of your life are down, you need to be careful what goes in and out. See, when you've got your spiritual walls up, what are you talking about? I'm talking about your prayer life is active. You're activating faith. You're in the house of God. You're serving people. I'm talking about the walls are up when you know that there's a quiet time happening during the weekend and you're opening the Word of God. But here's what happens when something takes place in our life where there's a disappointment, where maybe there's a hurt, maybe an offense builds up, a bitterness builds up. The walls of our spiritual life can start to come down. If we're not careful, we can disconnect from other believers. We can disconnect from the house of God. And it's in those moments where once the gate was narrow, where what's coming in and what's coming out, the people that are around you are more narrow. When the spiritual walls of our life come to the ground, anything can come in. And if you're not careful, anything can project out. We see that on people's social media accounts when hurt and disappointments come in. All of a sudden, what was a narrow lens starts to become a leakage of someone's heart or feelings into. The whole world gets to see this glimpse of someone who looked a certain way, spoke a certain way when things were narrow and things were protective and things were thought through. All of a sudden, the hurt, the offense, it starts to leak. And I want to say to you tonight, be super careful. When you know that the spiritual wars are down, because it's in that moment that the enemy wants to strike into your heart, into your mind. He wants to rob you. He wants to steal from you. And he wants to kill you. But the Word of God tells me that Jesus came to bring life and life to the full. Get those walls back up. Start praying again. Start calling on his name. If you don't know Jesus tonight, I'm going to give an opportunity in tonight's message to start that process of building the spiritual wall around your life. But be careful. We go to verse 4. We're about to learn a lot about the nature of Nehemiah. And this is Nehemiah writing. And when I heard these things about what was happening, I sat down and I wept. For some days I mourned and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. And then I said, and he goes off into this long prayer. He pours out his heart. We see a man who is not from Israel, that he doesn't know these people. He's never seen this place, Jerusalem, with his own eyes. Yet he hears the tragedy that the place of his ancestors is in ruins. And the first thing he does is he goes on Instagram and tells everyone. No, he doesn't. He sits down and he starts to weep. He lets out the emotions to say, I am crying out because I am so broken about the brokenness of people. In other words, the burden comes upon him from God for the people that aren't even people that he knows. But yet he knows that somewhere God places this sadness about what is happening. And I found in my life when God places a burden in our life, it's usually for us to do something about. When God places a sadness for us, that's something to do, not do with us, but about another thing. Like this year where we spoke about, hey, there are orphans right now that are coming in and out of the Ukraine that need our help. People stepped into that moment so sacrificially and gave financially to make a difference so that these amazing little orphans right now, over 1,000 of them are being fed every day and they're being housed because of your generosity on the edges of Poland. That's a burden playing out as a blessing. And even though this burden wasn't his, he chose to carry it. When you come across people's lives that are in ruins, how do you respond? If someone was to come up to you tonight and let you know that their marriage is falling apart and they don't know what to do, would you walk away from them and go, oh, this is too close to home, or I don't know. I don't want to get in the middle of this. Or would you be willing to step into that moment and say, hey, what can I do to help? Maybe a story this next week, or maybe a few months ago, of someone you know where they were running a business. It could have been a small business, could have been a big business, and they went bankrupt. Something happened where they made a poor decision, and all of a sudden, everyone lost their jobs. And now they're feeling the weight of that, and you know that they are in a situation where you know their heart, they're a good person, and they got themselves in the wrong spot. And yet either you go, there you go, it's a lesson that you learned, or do you step into the moment and say, what can I do to help? What can I do to be a blessing in your worst moment? Yeah, I can see that the ruins of your life, maybe you drove that nice car and you had that nice house, and now you are scrambling to find a rental property. What can I do to help? It's a very different spirit, like the Nehemiah spirit that he carried. Maybe you're here, and you know of a person who's lost their job, and there's nothing more awkward than that four-week period between somebody over here that's lost their job, and they might have got a new job, but you know there's going to be a four-week period before they actually have been paid again, and so there's this awkward transition of trying to pay the bills, and you could step in and be like, hey, man, can I buy you some food this week? And make a difference because you stepped into their moment while the walls were down, while there was ruins happening. I wonder, how would you respond if God put a burden on your heart to help someone else? I'm so thankful that all over the world this weekend, we have stepped into the moment on Serve Day to be the answers with single moms, families, disabilities, whatever it might be as a church, to say, hey, I guess, can I say, it's not just a one-off event. We want to be that all the time. Join one of the connect groups that helps in the community, but make a difference in the lives of people. And maybe it might be even having to step into the lives of a New South Wales Origin supporter, or a Wallaby supporter, or a Titan supporter, which I'm one of all of those. Just give me a hug after the service and just love me. It's tough times. The walls are down. Maybe you're here tonight and you can't carry someone else's burden because you are the person right now where your walls are down. Maybe you're the one where the marriage is falling apart. Maybe you're the person that's deep into an addiction right now and you don't know what to do. Maybe tonight you're the person that your boyfriend or girlfriend has just dumped you on a text message. And you're heartbroken. Maybe you're here tonight and you don't know how you're going to pay your mortgage this week, because you didn't factor the whole interest rate thing happening. Maybe you're skipping meals at home so your kids can eat. Joe, how can I carry someone else's burden when I can't even carry my own? And the great news is that this series is just for you. This series is going to help change your life. Not because I'm preaching it, but because God's word is going to come alive and spark in you hope, purpose, and future. At the very end of chapter 1, Nehemiah, after praying this big long prayer, he makes a statement that feels out of context for the story. He just simply says, I was a cupbearer to the king. Just a simple throwaway line. I was the cupbearer to the king. And at first glance, you think, well, a cupbearer, what is he, just like tasting wine all the time? Having a bit of cheese, a bit of brie, a bit of camembert, a bit of whatever he's having at the time. Jats, crackers, quince paste, whatever. I don't know what he's having. All we know would have been the finest to find, right? He's there with the Persian king. And you might be like, well, what's that? Well, let me tell you a bit about what the requirements were for a cupbearer. The cupbearer, outside of the king's wife, was the closest person to the king in terms of intimacy. They were the one that was always with them for the sole purposes of making sure they didn't die at every meal. A cupbearer had to be the equivalent of a modern-day lawyer. A cupbearer had to be extremely knowledgeable when it came to politics and the issues surrounding the day. A cupbearer had to be handsome. The cupbearer had to be a man. I'm sorry, girls, but that's just what the rules were. I didn't make the rules, just telling the rules. And so Nehemiah was a highly skilled young man. And every time a meal would come the king's way, he would be on standby ready. I don't think he would have had holidays. All times ready to go. If that was the drink that the king is about to have, his little Pepsi Max, up would step Nehemiah, and he would do this one. He'd say, "Long live the king." That's where the line comes from, that statement. Because in that moment, sometimes they would just drop dead because they would be poisoned. And the reason he would do that was to make sure that the king wouldn't be poisoned in that moment. Pretty important role. Pretty trusted role for a young Jewish boy to be there with King Artaxerxes, the Persian Iranian king. And that's where we pick up chapter 2. And I'm going to bring this story to a point that's going to really impact your life tonight, because I think it's for all of us. In the month of Nisan, which is 4 months later, so we know that he has a burden, he starts praying, and sometimes we want our prayers to be answered right now. Hey, I put a prayer request in, why is it not answered right now? This is 4 or 5 months later we're talking about. In the 20th year of King Artaxerxes, by the way, he was King Artaxerxes was the stepson of Queen Esther. It's pretty significant. The Persian king is the stepson of Queen Esther. When the wine was brought for him, I took the wine and gave it to the king. I had been sad in his presence. The king asked me, "Why does your face look so sad when you are not ill? This can be nothing but sadness of heart." I pause for a moment. The reason that is so important, everyone, is that I forgot to mention one other thing that was crucial for a cupbearer, is that they could only come into the king's court bringing joy and happiness. You could not be sad around the king. You were not allowed to be. That is why you see medieval history, like the jester in the courts, bringing laughter and joy. Like, I think a modern day Joey White would be in the king's court having a great time, a jester. So he would consistently turn up, "Long live the king," a smile on his face. I mean, it's pretty brave. Every time smiling on the king, "I hope I'm still here, that's good." Imagine tonight we're down at KFC, just stand up in the middle of a restaurant. "Long live the king." "Oh, I'm still going." And so clearly Nehemiah must have done a pretty good job to this point for a few months to carry this burden without it coming across his countenance. But when you understand that if you turn up sad into the presence of the king, you could be killed on the spot for that. And so he turns up and he can't hide it anymore. He can't hide from the king that I am not doing well. There is a burden, there is a sadness, there is a tragedy going on, and I can't keep it from you. And as much as fear is upon him, he can't hide it from the king. "And I was very afraid," verse 3, "but I said to the king, 'May the king live forever. Why should my face not look sad when the city where my fathers are buried in ruins and its gates have been destroyed by fire?' And the king said to me, 'What is it that you want?' And then I prayed to the God of heaven and I answered the king, 'If it pleases the king and your servant has found favor in the sight, let him send for me to the city of Judah where my fathers are buried so that I can rebuild it.'" It's a moment in time where God uses this burden that is placed on his heart with the preparation in that lead up to Nehemiah's life. Now, let me help you understand how God does things in our life. See, Nehemiah has got two parts of his life that collided in one moment. He's over here with this sadness and this burden that God has placed on him a few months earlier because he hears the stories of a city that has now been in ruins. At the same time, for years, he's back here working towards all the things that God has for his life. "I'm going to be a lawyer. I'm going to be a politician. I'm going to be a man of integrity. I'm going to keep working my way forward. I don't know why I'm here. I don't know what's going on." And as he keeps moving forward, his burden is over here. The blessing of his life and that he's now close to the king, those two things merge together, and the burden and the blessing in that moment all make sense that now God will make a way through the king for him to minister from. He didn't know that. It's like me when I was at university. I didn't know that me finishing an economics degree all those years ago, which now I used to think, what's the point of that? But now running a fairly large church with a lot of complexities around finances and structures and systems, I got to tell you, the way my brain works, it actually really has worked out well that the burden, the blessing collides. There's things that you'll go through in life, you'll say, that doesn't make sense at the moment. Why did I have to lose that friend? Why did I have to lose my family member early? Why did I have to go through that thing where that person was, that abuse took place? But yet along the way, God gives us these burdens, this empathy, these concerns. And when those two things merge together, the burden and the blessing, that's when God steps into the story and things open up. And that's when you can move forward. I don't know, watching online tonight, there might be some of you here, you can't even walk into a church right now because the burden's so heavy, the walls are so low, and you're going, God, what was the point of that? I'm telling you, keep moving forward because at some point the burden and the blessing will collide with each other. As soon as you stop moving, as soon as you stagnant, you're dead in the water. Keep moving forward. Keep pushing forward. And so Jeremiah turns up. He's been given this permission by the king. He's been given letters. He takes this 1,100-kilometer journey on a horse. He's probably like walking like this now. And he gets there because he's a cupbearer, right? He's not riding a horse all the time. He's a cupbearer. He's, you know, having wine and cheese, as we heard. And now he's got chafing. He's really struggling. He gets to Jerusalem. And he finally sees. Now, here's some context. I'm going to show you quickly this video. I forgot to mention it earlier. Let me show you this video. This is from 2019. I was there in Israel. Can we show that video just quickly? I'm going to throw them on the spot here. They're like, oh, he forgot about it. Hopefully you haven't forgotten about me as well in the back room. Okay, here we go. Excellent. This is my perspective from the Mount of Olives looking towards Jerusalem. That is part of the wall that surrounds, that's the western side. At the top there is the Mount of Olives. Down the bottom is where Jesus is, Gethsemane. And that big gold dome there is called the Rock of the Dome. Now, here's a bit of context for you. That area, if you're Jewish right now, you cannot go into on the top. You can only go down below it, which is a place called the Wailing Wall, which is the remnants of Solomon's temple. The very top is actually reserved for those of the Islam faith. And that is where they go to focus on the place where Abraham and Isaac met at the rock. It's a very, very, I'm not here to speak on that topic, but this is about Christianity, right? So you've got this hotbed of Christians. You've got Jews, Christians, and Muslims all in this one area, worshipping, for Muslims, Allah, God, and for us, God. You've got, obviously, as Christians, you've got Jesus involved, where people coming to the holy city to say, where was Jesus crucified? You've got Jews there going, Jesus was never real. I mean, there's all this complexity going on. There is this spiritual tension that you feel when you go there that you'll never feel anywhere else. Like, you go, you see Galilee, it's beautiful and peaceful. You go down to, like, the places where, like, David was as a shepherd are beautiful. You get into Israel, into Jerusalem, you're like, oh, gee, what is happening here? Ellen freaked out the first day. She freaked out. She was like, whoa, what am I feeling? Because you've got all these tensions in one place. If you do a close-up here for a second, this is a closer look of the wall. So you can see the size of these walls we're talking about here. These weren't small. This was like the whole city was surrounded by these deep, wide walls. And that particular gate, because there was 12 gates that surrounded Jerusalem, you'll see it's blocked up. The entranceway is blocked up, and that's called the Gate Beautiful. That's where in Acts 4 you see Peter and John are out, you know, at the gate, and then along comes, Peter and John come to the temple to worship, and you've got the blind man that's sitting at the gates at Gate Beautiful. That's the place right there. And if you understand the Bible and the book of Revelation, that gate plays a really significant role, and that is why the Muslims have actually bricked it up so that the king can't return through it. That's another series. But that gives you an idea of what the sort of walls we're talking about that were gone. Now, I don't want to ruin the story, but in chapter 6 of Nehemiah, we find out that old mate Nehemiah builds these walls in 52 days. The whole city is rebuilt. Something about Nehemiah walking into the scenario with his burden and rallying the people of Israel, they build in 52 days the walls of Jerusalem, and we'll get to that point. But it's interesting when he arrives that it tells us in verse 12, it says, I had not told anyone what God had put in my heart to do for Jerusalem. Listen to me carefully tonight. When God puts a burden on your heart, you've got to know the right time to share that burden. You've got to know the right time to share vision. It's not the time to just go sharing it everywhere until the right moment. At the same time as well, when you share vision and you share burden, make sure it's with the right people. They will be shot down real quick. And in Jeremiah chapter 2, verse 17, as the band comes and joins me, we see the end of this story where Nehemiah has now gone for an inspection of what you see there that was disappeared. And he basically reports, this is worse than I thought. Like, I'd heard the stories, but this is a mess. Like, Jerusalem not only is lacking walls, but it's got no vision. And so at first he turns up with a pastoral heart, is everyone okay, to realizing it's not just going to be pastoral that's going to get us through this, but I've got to turn up and bring vision to people that have lost vision. I've got to come back and speak to people about what hope could look like if hope was in the mix. And we pick it up in verse 17, he says, "And then I said to them, you see the trouble we are in, Jerusalem lies in ruins and its gates have been burned with fire. Come, let us rebuild the walls." This is vision, right? "Come, let us rebuild the wall of Jerusalem and we will no longer be in disgrace. And I also told them about the gracious hand of my God upon me when the king had said to me," what the king had said to me, "and they all replied, let us start rebuilding. So they began this good work." I'm telling you, sometimes in a workplace, sometimes in a university, sometimes in a marriage, sometimes in a family, all it takes is one person that can see the potential, that can see the possibilities, that can turn up in the moment and say, "I can see a better day." Hey, when we started this church here on the Gold Coast, I'm telling you, God put a burden in my spirit and in my heart. They said, "Hey, there's something better for this city. There's something that doesn't belong here yet. It hasn't been built. We've got to step into the moment." And I want to tell you tonight, there is something about when God places a burden on people's hearts and they can step into a moment. They can step into the situation and they can bring hope, not just for themselves, but for everyone. And here's what happens. Just as he's sharing the good news, the vision, verse 19, "But when Sanballat the Horonite, Tobiah the Ammonite, and Geshem the Arab heard about it, they mocked and they ridiculed us. 'What is this you're going to do?' they asked. 'Are you rebelling against the king?'" Remember, they've turned up with the authority of the king. "And I answered them by saying," catch this, "'the God of heaven will give us success. We, his servants, will start rebuilding. But as for you, you have no share in Jerusalem or any claim or any historic right to it.'" It's in this moment that Nehemiah could have pulled out his positional card. It's in this moment that Nehemiah could have said, "Oi, I'm here because of the king. I've got these papers. It's on my business card that I'm here in charge of this rebuild." But it's in this moment that Nehemiah chooses to go beyond human thinking. He goes beyond the natural and he says, I could do all those things. I could tell you about what right I have to be here. But I'm choosing to let you know that no matter what man thinks and no matter what somebody thinks about what I can do, I'm here to tell you that when God says that something is about to happen, when a burden comes on my heart that is going to pull down the walls and rebuild it for what God has, no man can get in the way. No person can get in the way. No position can get in the way. Someone here needs to hear this tonight. It maybe looks like right now it's impossible in that workplace situation where you're being bullied. I believe it's possible that this week that God can move his hand and that person can be removed right now. You might find in a marriage right now saying, "It's impossible that my husband or my wife would ever come to church." But tonight you don't know what's up to when you appeal to the throne room of God and you say, "I need God for you to move the heart of my husband or my wife." They could be sitting next to you next week. Maybe a friend that has been laughing and ridiculing you over the years that you go to church. I'm going to believe at the end of this series, they'll be sitting next to you and going, "Man, I believe what you believe." Do not despise what God can do when you put your positional thinking away and say, "I appeal to God, the throne room of heaven, the King of Kings, the one that is above it all, before all, and went before us, and he's going to go after us." Somebody here needs to hear this tonight, that God wants to bring hope into your situation. So Joe, you're telling me Nehemiah turns up and, let me get this right, he's got a burden from God and God sends him with the authority to do this and there's opposition? Isn't like things supposed to be really easy when God puts it on your heart? Isn't that how it works? That'd be nice. I would argue the point. If there isn't opposition, whether God even said it in the first place. See, a hallmark of what God does, the economy of God, is that when he puts something on your heart, you need to also be aware it wakes up the enemy. Because they don't want you to go from comfortable to uncomfortable, or visionless to vision, hopeless to hope. When the enemy gets a sniff, you could do something great for God, opposition becomes the norm. Just depends on whether you can handle it or not. That's called character. It's called trust in God. Maybe you're facing opposition right now. Maybe there's something going on where you're like, it's real, the opposition I'm feeling. The strain I'm under, the stress I'm feeling. And here's what I want to say to you. If God said that he's going to do it, he's going to do it. You just got to keep moving forward by faith. Would you stand to your feet tonight? Those of you in Seoul, I want to tell a story about what happened last week. I didn't share it with you when I was in Seoul because it was inappropriate, but I'll share it after the fact. Right as I was getting ready to leave from Sydney, I live on the Gold Coast, so I had to fly to Sydney first, and there's been no direct flights at the moment. So I wish I could tell you a better story than this. I wish I really could tell you that something adventurous happened. But I was putting my shoes on. I was putting my shoes on. Dr. Joe, this is not a good story. I was putting my shoes on. And I got up too quickly. And all of a sudden, I'm in the hotel room in Sydney, and it's like somebody shoots me with a gun in my back, and my whole back just freezes and just cramps up. And from my knees up to the middle of my back, it feels like I've been paralyzed. I'm just like stuck. And I wander across and lie on my bed, and I can't move. I'm thinking, what have I just done? I'm old. I didn't even hurt myself playing rugby like this. Playing cricket, bowling 25 overs in a day. I had back issues. What is going on? And I had to go to Korea the next morning, and so I somehow managed to take some painkillers and prayed, of course, and got to the airport, and Moni and Joey were like, oh my gosh, I was walking like an old man like this. I was like this. Literally. And I was like, I'm going. God's told us to go. We're going. You got to understand, we're here to pioneer fresh new ground there in Seoul. The leader goes first. It's his responsibility. So we turned up in there in Seoul, and it got worse and worse. And by Thursday last week, I was in hospital in Seoul. Such was the pain. It was too much. Like, and I've got a really high pain threshold. And so I'm there in this hospital in downtown Seoul in a little Asian hospital gown. It was a bit small for me. It's like 3/4 size pants. I was like, I'm not gonna say, oh, got something to do. Seeing the doctor. And it was an amazing healthcare system, by the way. I won't tell you the story right now, all of it. But I'm lying after having a pain injection in my back. I'm lying on this bed with a drip in my arm, and I'm getting all these missed calls from Ellen back here in Australia. And then Joey lets me know, he goes, Ellen, you need to call Ellen. Your daughter Summer is in hospital on the Gold Coast right now. And I think her appendix is about to rupture, explode, obliterate, whatever. Like, you know. And so I'm there on the bed. Well, I'm saying, Joey, tell her to pray for me. I'm lying here as well and I can't move. And Joey's like the middleman. He's like, okay. I'm lying there. And then Sai and his beautiful wife, Diane, who's been hosting us over there, and they started a connect group there, and all of a sudden, all these people are coming to church there at Glow Soul. We haven't started yet. We're in the car, and we start talking about opposition when you start taking ground. Next thing, he gets a call from Diane and says that their little daughter, who's less than 1 year of age, has broken out into all these hives and this rashes, and she's on the way to hospital with the baby. And then Moni has an injury from the day before that starts to work itself out. He can't walk. So you got me and Moni walking through to the hotel like this together. Ice packs. My daughter's over here and she's now sleeping in hospital because they're not sure what's going to happen. Sai's daughter is on the way to the hospital. And we stop and we just start praying and say, God, it's not an accident. There's no coincidence that we're here breaking brand new ground here in Seoul. And clearly, I'm excited for you there in Seoul. Something big is going to happen that he would try and take us out before we even got to the airport. And while we were trying to even get to the Sunday to say, we're here to start something fresh and new that brings hope to Seoul. Oh, that's a coincidence. Yeah, I'd say it's maybe if I hurt my back, but not all those other things put together. Like, Joey, call your family, pray for them. because opposition will come your way when you take ground. Hey, if you want to be comfortable and have no opposition, keep watching Netflix. It's great. Hey, you want to keep it engaging in the late night hangouts with people that just, you know, used to be Christians and now want to pull you away from faith, you go for that. But for those of you that actually have a heart to serve others, and for those of you that have got a call from God to make a difference, if those of you got a burden that God's placed on the inside of you, I'm telling you, you need to expect there's going to be some opposition up in here. And I wonder if a generation of young people would be big enough to realize that there is no force that is greater than God Almighty. When He calls you to assignment, when He gives you a project, when you are willing to step into the burden, that is when burden and blessing, they collide together. And even though right now my back is sore, I will keep preaching through this pain and say that Jesus is the healer, Jesus is the savior, Jesus brings hope, Jesus brings potential, Jesus brings future, Jesus brings forgiveness, Jesus brings purpose. There in Seoul, get excited. Here on the Gold Coast, get excited. There in Sydney, new ground is being taken in the West. Get ready. In Melbourne, those of you in the UK, young people that are here tonight, get ready for what God wants to do. Don't get satisfied with being comfortable. Don't get satisfied with staying in the norm. You're called to be different. You're called to set that light on fire in that region. Father, we pray right now, Lord. Across this room, come on, if you're here tonight, at the start of this series, we just lift your hands to heaven and say, hey, I want in on all that you've got for me, God. Whether your walls are down tonight or whether your walls feel like they need to be rebuilt, whether you're the person who's carrying a burden or you're the person who can help others carry their burden, we ask right now in the mighty name of Jesus for a fresh touch from God over every person watching online right now. At the start of this series on Nehemiah, while we speak to hearts that feel like they need to be restored tonight, we speak to those that maybe feel like their walls are absolutely smoldering on the ground and there's no hope in sight. I pray, Lord, over people that maybe have lost sense or lost sight of the call of God in their life, that God, on the other side of people's pain, on the other side of people's hurt, on the other side of offense, at the same time, God, where the burden and the blessing meet, there is your provision, there is your protection, there is your direction, there's your authority, Father. And I pray right now, Lord, in every home, in every person that is in the room, that as we start this series, stir our hearts for what stirs yours, God. Let us be the person who steps into the moment, not away from it. Let us be that person who speaks life and not death. Let us be the kinds of people who speak hope and not hopelessness. We declare that tonight, Lord, at the start of this series, that anyone who's facing opposition right now, in Jesus' name, you are their protector and you are their provider and you are their healer. We place the blood around every person of you, Jesus. Amen. Hey, with every eye closed tonight, come on, they're online, just wherever you are.